cloud operations at Huawei Munich Research Center in Germany, also the associate professor at the University of Coimbra in Portugal. His research interests include but not limited to cloud computing, business process management, the Internet of Services, and service engineering. So it's 4 minutes earlier, but still we can please welcome Professor George Cardoso.
Thank you very much for the introduction. Should we wait a little bit more, or do you want me to start?
I think we can wait for 3 to 4 minutes.
Okay, good.
Yeah, thank you. Hi, Professor. If you don't mind, I think we can start now.
Okay, good. So thank you to everyone to participate in the SRE Summit. The topic this morning will be about distributed traces and log analysis. I will talk more about distributed traces. I will just have one slide to motivate to log analysis, because we feel that it's also an important area to do more research on. So Huawei Cloud, most of the work that we do is done for the infrastructure that delivers Huawei Cloud. Just for as a background information, Huawei Cloud is getting quite large worldwide. You see some numbers on the right side. We had, so this slide is a few months old, so it's possible that the numbers are not correct actually anymore. But 44 availability zones, 23 regions, more than 180 services. So it's getting quite large, and you can start comparing it, with Amazon or Azure or Google Cloud, and we are moving into this direction. To have such a large infrastructure with worldwide coverage, there is a very important area, which is SRE, and this is the topic of the summit. And what is SRE doing? Well, SRE is doing a lot of different tasks, and you can see here the tasks. So we are parting from all these tasks. What we try to do is to bring automation. If we bring automation, then obviously these tasks are executed by machines and not by humans. To bring automation, there are several techniques and approaches. We use AI, so we try to improve automation via AI. And from all the tasks that you see here, I will select a few of them that we concentrate on. So we do not cover many of the tasks that you see here are not yet covered, but in the future, I think there is more area to do research. So we work in a field called AI Ops. So it stands for AI for operations. So you try to bring AI for the operation of IT systems. Here, this slide brings some motivation. I will not go into these details, but I will concentrate on this one. Right. So in the previous slide, we saw that SRE they carry a lot of tasks, and we are particularly interested in system monitoring, troubleshooting, and resolution of operation issues. So this is our work focuses here. But SRE is also, you know, SRE and operation maintenance team are also carrying out other tasks like backup, restoration, update, change, capacity management, configuration management. This presentation will then cover these two activities. So the activities, you see them here again, and we will especially concentrate on this one, troubleshooting and resolution of operational issues. And this activity, we carry it into a very specific type of systems, and these ones are the services from Huawei Cloud that usually we look into. So OBS is the storage service, EVS volume service, VPC network, and ECS, and this is the cloud or creation of VMs. So we concentrate on those four type of systems, but obviously the solutions, they are, you can generalize them and they can be applied to any service. We focus on specific service. It's a little bit easier to do research. You are able to be more focused on the problems. And so troubleshooting applied to, for example, OBS or EVS, what do we exactly do? I mean, troubleshooting is a huge field. And we actually do generally anomaly detection. We do. I will also show actually root cause analysis together. But I will concentrate on here to only mention anomaly detection. So what we want to understand is when you have OBS system running, would we be able to actually detect anomalies and then do the root cause analysis, which means to understand which part of the system is failing. If you do anomaly detection, you have several ways to do it. I will show two techniques, and the techniques is using traces and using logs. When you do anomaly detection, you may use trace analysis or log analysis, and you may apply these techniques to different dimensions of anomaly detection. So, you know, when you do anomaly detection, you can look at response time. So you look at response time of subsystems. And if it takes a little bit more time than usual, you say, well, most likely I have an anomaly and I will try to do root cause analysis. Obviously, you can also do, you know, system load, error analysis, and system saturation. These four elements that you see here, they have a reason to be here. They are identified by Google and are called the golden signals. So this is why it's they are good candidates. But this usually it's a challenge. I mean, to understand which signals bring value to your anomaly detection algorithm is not trivial. See, most algorithms for anomaly detection that you have for the past 30, 40 years from the field of economics or time series analysis, you can reuse them, but then you need to know to which metrics actually you can apply it. This is usually a challenge. Okay, but stepping back a little bit, so we look into troubleshooting. We will try to understand anomaly detection, how we can do it. And we will look into four different type of monitoring data that comes from Huawei Cloud and from most cloud providers that we can use. So you can apply anomaly detection techniques in logs, and logs is what you see here. So you have a file, a text file, and inside usually you have, you know, time, it starts with a timestamp, and then it gives you the error level, and then it gives you a description of the problem. This usually it's somehow hard to understand and to parse. And we will see that you may take 15 minutes or half an hour actually to debug when servers, if a server has a problem and you really want to understand the root cause, this may take a lot of time. Now, let's assume that we are talking about 15 minutes. If you multiply that by tens or hundreds of servers that can be related to a failure, obviously this is not scalable from the human perspective. You can also decide to use metrics, and metrics usually it's time series, so it's sequences of numbers. So you see here he says there is a tag, and you know it comes from a machine with a certain IP in a certain availability zone, and then you have here the payload, the data, and all these sequences of numbers here, this is a time series. And what usually we try to do is which of those numbers is an anomaly. So if you look at it, you know, they all start with 2, and here you have one that starts with 3. So you'd say, oh, maybe here I have a spike, and whatever was here, maybe this is an anomaly. This needs to be decided. If you find an anomaly here, then you say, oh, this server here probably has a problem. We need to check it. Traces are a little bit more complex. Yesterday there was a presentation about traces. Traces, I will give you more details about it, but this is what you see in the data structure. So here you see it's some kind of dictionary with key values, and it gives you information about how a request from a user or customer was handled. So here, you know, the status code of the customer was 200. Here you see the service that I actually tried to access. And this is actually the URL. And then it will give you some information about the protocol and the service name that the user tried to access. And you have also the IP number. This is a very small example. Usually it's way larger. And this is why traces become quite hard to process. Then you can also have events, you know, important things that happen within the infrastructure, such as there was, here you see examples, there is a packet loss, or maybe there was an upgrade of the service. So the notion of event is quite broad. From all these types, there is still another type that I don't show, for example, topologies, which can also be used to do anomaly detection. But from all the types that you see here, I will talk a little bit about logs, just a little bit, and then we will try to understand better what traces are for and how can we exploit them. This is log analysis, and we call it log intelligent log analysis because we use quite some AI. This slide gives you a very high level perspective on the problem and one research direction that can be taken. So this is here, top left side, you see the problem. So this as is, you see here in the background, I mean, the image is a little bit small, but you understand that this is text file, right? So, and the question is, if you have several gig of those logs being generated, let's say 10 million lines, how can you find the problem in 10 million lines of logs? So it takes you quite some time. So in some simulations that we did, you know, it takes 2 hours. So you take 2 hours to actually discover the problem. So I give you a log and you can use the grep tool, and you know, you will probably grep for words like error, connection failure, file failure. And if I will give you 10 million lines, maybe in 2 hours you can find the problem. The question is, can we do it faster? All right, in practice, obviously we don't give 10 million lines to operators. Usually, they know that the problem occurred at 9, from 9 to 9:10, so they will only have to look at 10 minutes of logs, which can still be a large number. But let's assume that, you know, a single node check will take, you know, 15 minutes. You have an operator that is experienced, it will take 15 minutes. This is where the problem lies. 15 minutes is way too much time. And when you look at these text files here on the background, could we have a graphical representation? Now, I put here images just to give you a feeling of what this graphical representation will look like. And we would like to have other tools. We don't want to look at the Discord files, and we want to look at maybe graphical representation that will be easier to interpret. Log analysis exists for quite some years, I would say 20 years, or quite some research. But it never really went to this graphical part. When you see it here, obviously you see a graph here, but this is, again, some form of time series analysis over the logs, which are abstracted using something called template mining and template analysis. And this is still low level, so it is visualization somehow, but I think it's way too low level, because here this red dip here, you know, points at most likely a log record that it's unusual, and this is far away from log analysis. Nonetheless, recent work has shown that machine learning can be used to process logs, and we've been looking. And here I will just give you a very high description of one research direction that can be taken. Is you start with traditional tools. So this is the same tool that you see here. So it's ELK, and here you can see the count of, you know, let's assume lines of logs, so log records with a tag error. For some reason, somebody activated the level for errors to be displayed. And you look here and you say, well, you know, it's kind of constant, so I would assume that there is no problem in my log. If you would have a spike, right, you'd say, oh, maybe a service has a problem. Here we don't really see anything. If you had a spike, you look into the logs still manually, and you go back to this manual analysis that will take you 15 minutes. What we are looking at is ways to get this information, to extract, let's say, to abstract the logs and extract more meaningful information. So maybe some semantics, and here you start having the colors. And the colors will provide obviously more information than the top, and you'll have maybe less colors. So here you see 10,000 error messages, and then you would go for, let's say, maybe 100 templates by abstraction, right? And then when you have the abstraction, if you can add some semantics to it, then you have less and you have colors. And then you could still process this information with some, let's say, correlation or clustering, and you'll have even less events. And then at the end, what you'll have is something like this that tells you the six more important events that happen here. And maybe you can do a historical analysis and see that one event is related to failures or errors. And again, as I said, we've done quite some research in this field for the past now 2 years. I think there are still a lot of to be done. So this is a state of the art. So if you go outside and you want to hire a company to provide you a top tool, so this is what you get. We would like to go more into this direction to have tools and solutions that give you better solutions. What needs to be done to look into more visualization and abstraction? So we would like to have bird eyes view, zoom in, zoom out of the information. This will be very interesting. Here you have also some visualization that you could implement, network diagrams, correlation matrices. So again, we don't want to look at text, we want to look at the information that is inside these log files. Challenges: performance is a challenge. Processing all these text files is very, very expensive. When you compare log analysis to metric analysis is extremely fast. It's just numbers, sequences of numbers, and this is processed extremely fast versus processing strings, and this is what you have in the logs. The second technique that you can use for anomaly detection and root cause analysis is trace analysis. This slide has the overview, then I will go into a detail of an example which may be interesting. This is state of the art also. This is Elastic APM, and this is a trace. So a customer made a request to one of our systems, and this live line represents all the subsystems that were used to handle this request. So maybe it was the web server, then he went to the network, then he went to a database, then he went to storage, then he went to get an IP, for example. And you can trace everything that happened. So it's some kind of roadmap. And nowadays, there is one limitation, is the tools only gives you visualization. This is the only thing you get. And now you have to figure out if this is abnormal. So in some cases, it's easy, because one of the tags here will be, one of the bars will be associated with an error generated by a subsystem. And you'll see, let's assume that this is red, and red means there is a problem. So this is visualization. You can detect it. You can even analyze it automatically. So obviously this is trivial. But there are cases where there is no error being generated. So you have latency problems, for example, it's one case. Or another case where there is a problem, but it's not reported as an error. So meaning that this will not give you information about specific cases where the system fails. And then what you have to do is to start compare. So, you know, you look at this one and you look at another trace from last week and you say, well, it does look similar, so we should not have a problem. Or, yeah, it looks different because this bar is way longer. Obviously, this is feasible if you have a small system. Obviously, it's impossible if you have millions of traces like this, so a human cannot study this. So what we go is, again, to use machine learning and AI to process these sequential data. So this is called sequential data because it's basically sequences of function calls. I will show, we will dig deeper into this. So I will actually give you an example how AI works, and not for you to actually learn how to do it by yourself, but it will give you an idea of the steps that are involved. Here, for example, I will show you an example of the overall idea that we follow. We analyze historical traces. So, for example, from last week, we collect maybe 1 million traces, and then we create a model. So this is the first part. So what you see here, it's maybe hard to understand, but this number here, which is very small, this is a trace ID. So it's the identification of one trace. And then here we have a way to display them. And if you look at them here, I mean, they are, let's say most of them are similar, I would say. And then you have this greenish here that seems to be different for some reason. And we use then historical data, we create a model like this, and then we use this model in the future when new traces come. And we will, for example, detect that, you know, these new traces that came is not really similar and there is a problem here, for example. And then we will try to extract where the problem exactly lies. And then we would say the problem is related with host, this host, and this is a service, this is a function. So again, here the problem is large scale. I mean, how do you process millions of traces and extract meaningful information? Here again, you have another graphical representation. This is just a mockup. Where would you have here the trace, for example? And the operator will see this this color here where I said that there is a change of structure or change of latency. So two things may happen. Usually it's a structural latency. Structure means that the colors that you see here are just different. So suddenly you see this blue point here and you say, oh, there is a change of structure. So therefore my trace is anomalous. Let me see what's wrong with it. Or the structure is correct. So that all the colors of a line are correct. But there is a change of latency, meaning that it took more time than usual. So those are two types of problems that can be tackled. So going into more details about traces. So trace analysis is interesting. We can see that it's useful to troubleshoot systems. How do we apply it? Well, in our case, usually we use OpenStack. So we deploy OpenStack in testbeds. Huawei Cloud, the base infrastructure is also OpenStack, and this is the architecture. And for example, here you have your user. He makes a call into the system because he wants to create a VM, and then the system, the entry point of the system, will make other calls to subsystems. So here you see the names. So this is OpenStack architecture, part of the architecture, and this is also some of the components of OpenStack. So our customer here makes a call, he wants to create a VM, and then the request will go to OpenStack Nova API, then it will go to certification, to scheduler, it will, you know, send a message to RabbitMQ, that will go to compute node, that will go to KVM to start a virtual machine. And then here, the identification service requested the verification of a token, and it went to the identity service. At some point, the VM is being created and it will ask for an IP, for example, or for storage. And this path that you see here, this is what we can collect using tracing technology. So you would see all the path. And when a path has, you know, one node missing, you could say, the execution was not correct, and you could identify where the problem was. Or you could also use latency, meaning that the path is known, but it took more time in this stage, for example. And again, you can do identification of the problem. How do you do this in practice? I mean, we know that it seems like tracing would be really useful. Who is using it? Nowadays, I think it's quite mature. There are a lot of tools available. Open tracing is a good candidate. You see here some tracing standard, open telemetry, open tracing, open sensors. They are all being somehow merged or related. And this is from the standard perspective, open source tool, if you want to use it, Zipkin, quite old now, quite mature. You could also, you can use it if you have microservice architecture and you want to implement tracing. From the commercial side, Google has Stackdriver, which is traces, and Amazon has X-Ray, which is also tracing capabilities. And you have a couple of, I think it's already identified a couple of startup companies that only specialize in tracing. This is the case of Lightstep. So this is the technology that we use, or people can use in general, to implement tracing into their system. This is the result. This chart, this one is generated automatically, actually. This one, it's just an example. And again, this is the path which is followed when a user interacts with OpenStack. You see here the authentication. This is authentication service. So the question again here is this sequence correct or not? And does it happen most of the time like this? And also the delays. So is there any delay in the call? How do we analyze this? Well, obviously we need to abstract. There are several ways to do it. I will show you three. There are more than three ways, but it will give you an idea. One is to go to the back old stochastic processes and to model as a Markov chain. So here you have the states S1, 3, 4, 5, which would correspond to spans of a trace, so it's a sub-element, you know, and state S1 went to S2. So this will be the systems, for example, that we saw. And you model, so you you learn over a month all the possible transitions from states, and you build a model, a probabilistic model. When you have a new trace, you just ask the question, does this new trace, which was generated 2 or 3 seconds ago, does it match this model? If it does not, you would know that it's anomalous, and then you still need to do the root cause analysis. This sometimes it's costly because processing these models may take time, and they may actually be quite large. So there are advantages and disadvantages. Tree structure, a little bit better. Trees tend to be easier to process than graphs. Obviously, you lose some information, but it's another possibility. And then you can view it as a sequence. For example, A was executed and B, C, D, and E. Obviously, sequences are much easier, but obviously you lose a lot of information when you go to sequence. But again, at the end, it's a trade-off. You lose some information, modeling information, but the question is this modeling information important, really important for the root cause analysis? If it's only marginally important, then you can just drop it and you go into a simpler structure and maybe you use a more advanced technique to detect the problems. This is what we did in sequence. We went into sequence analysis. We are going deeper. So we could model Markov chains, trees, or sequence, and we say, well, let's see how we could do it with using sequences. Sequence analysis, it has also a few years. You see here a reference paper from sequence learning. It's 20 years, so it has been done quite a lot. And here we look into sequence prediction, sequence classification, sequence generation, sequence to sequence prediction. We will only look into these two, and the approach that I will describe will go into sequence classification. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, is it normal or not? So this is a sequence that I want to check. And again, this represents a trace. Actually, the approach that I show also matches prediction, but it's the internal working of the algorithm that uses prediction to achieve classification. This is more detailed, so it goes into the details of this approach, but it's still, I would say, fairly high level. You can see the paper. The work has been done with the Technical University of Berlin last year, and you can read the paper if you want. It's not an easy paper to follow, but if you really want to implement it, then you can read it and spend some time with it. Again, the overall idea: the user creates a command. He wants to create a server, for example. The request goes via several machines or servers or services that have to handle the request. And we track the path, and here, this representation here, this is actually a model of the latency. So we track not only the sequence, but also the latency. A distributed trace is generated. I kind of show it to you. And then what we do is we create a sequence. So A1, 62, E2, 28, those are references for a trace for something which is called spans, which is just sub-elements of a trace. And then we go into sequence classification. So for each type of request the user can execute, we have all these numbers. And obviously this is this encoding here. It's shown like this to kind of illustrate that the problem is difficult. So at the end is you have this huge sequence of letters, and just the question is this correct or not? This is the base idea. So each number here, for example 16, corresponds to V2 port. So the trace was trying to acquire a network port, and 51 is also related to ports, but then there is here a variable, so it's probably trying to acquire a specific port, and here is not another compute. So all these pairs of numbers, they correspond actually to one of those events. And then here, function called sequences. Here actually there is a sequence encoded. Why is this difficult? Well, this seems to be simple, but it's difficult because of the way the software is built, especially distributed systems. So you have things such as a retry pattern, meaning that a service A tries to invoke a service B, and it fails, it retries, and then eventually succeeds. You know, number three succeeds with error code or status code 200. And because you have these problems here, the traces will have different configurations. So you have A, B, C, D, E, which would be the correct one. A, B, C, C, D, E, not clear if it's correct. I mean, it's just trying again. So maybe you still consider that it's right. And here you have A, B, C, 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 D, E, and here you would assume also correct, and then here you have a Z, it's wrong because it was not able to access. So suddenly you have this T1 to T3, they are correct, but you never seen them. I mean, maybe you never saw the CCCC where it retried three times. And we don't want to have false positive, so you need to have a way to handle it. Here is caching is also a big problem, because caching means that some spans are generated sometimes, but not always. So those two here, they are both correct, just because one didn't have information, I had to go to the cache system, had to generate it to store it in the cache system. And here you had the information, so you would not see a certain step. Again, both are correct, but you may not be able to see them at training time. Here, the problem is harder to solve. The trace generated is dependent on a parameter that may come from the user, meaning that if the user in the same function call requests to create one VM or 500 VMs, you'd get all these variations. So you could get the C, for example, 500 times. And again, you may not see it often, how many times a user creates 500 VMs with one call. Unlikely, so you might create a model that will never have it. How can you model this information? So you have all these details of modeling that actually come from software development. They are not really related to problems of the system, but because software development is in a certain way, the choices will change. I think I do not have too much time. I will try just to briefly give you an idea of how AI works. So this is distributed choice analysis with something called LSTMs. Is a type of neural networks. And the challenge, it's always to encode the problem. So this is here OpenStack, and you see here, this is just a small prototype that was built on, but it's like a simulator, where here we have sequences of choices that are generated, right? So Keystone, the first one of API, and with a probability of happening. Here we try to simulate cache, for example. And when such a choice is generated in practice, you will have a certain configuration, choice zero. And then what we need to do is to transform this into sets of sequences of number. I already showed this previously, because internally AI would only do matrix multiplication. So AI, it's only about matrix multiplication. So therefore, we all need to always need to have this mapping. Here, other steps that we have to carry out to create our model of numbers. So again, this is a sequence. This is a sequence of execution of choices. We need to apply something like padding. Why? Because matrices cannot have different size of rows. So this is another task that you do. And then you need to remove all these numbers, three sixes, because again, internally, the way machine learning works only accepts one and zeros in this specific type of network. And this is called one-hot encoding. So what you have at some point is all these choices that I've shown, they are all encoded into vectors of one and zeros. And now you have this huge matrix that you need to start processing it by multiplying numbers. I will skip this, lack of time. And I will just show you the results. So this is the results. As a summary, I created, so I took all the choices generated by a system, OpenStack, over 1 or 2 days. I transformed them into vector sequences of numbers. And now I process these sequences of numbers and I try to learn them using LSTM networks. And now I will use this model. This model took 12 hours to process, which to create, which is optimistic. It may take far more than 12 hours to create. And now I'm going to use it. How do I use it? Well, when a user issues a new command to Huawei Cloud, I will just get the choice generated and I will ask the model, is this choice valid or invalid? And here we have a test. So I have two choices. So I received two choices from my customer. So this is the first one and the second one. Obviously the red one, you already know that it's a faulty one, and the green one is the correct one. I give this vector into my model, and here it's the prediction. So here the test is the choice, and I will ask to predict if he's correct or not. I get the result, and then I will process this result, the Y hat, and he will identify anomalies. How does he identify anomalies? Well, he will try to compute somehow, I will try to simplify, to compute the distance of this vector with all the vectors or choices in the model, and here you see the result. And it tells you that the first part of the choice, meaning the first event, the first, the second, the third, they are all quite similar or close to the model, except this one, the one with indice 4. You see here this very low number will indicate that there is an anomaly. When I pass the second one, the green, and I ask the same question, is this valid? I get this matrix, and you know all the numbers are somehow okay. So they are within the certain threshold. So as a result, we know, oh, I have a problem with indice number 4. This is very similar, so I will not go into to the description. But when you know that it's indice number 4, you can go now to the original input, which was indice number 4, 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. And this 5, since you have the encoding, you know what it is. You know that it's maybe Nova API, we saw examples. And you know the choice, the information about the span that has a problem, and you can have the host IP, for example. You can have the latency, and then you have to do further processing. With the technical university, we went a little bit further. So what I explained was relatively simple. It's an example only. It's not what's it in the paper that I described. It's not what you have. This was just a very high conceptual description of how the problem is solved. If you read the paper, you'll see that actually what's being proposed is different in the sense that we analyze sequences at the same time of response time. So we try to solve it. And obviously the network that you have at the end is far more complex than the one that I've shown. Who is doing more work? Well, trace analysis got traction over time. And we found some work from Facebook, which I found was interesting because it was a very different approach. It's a little bit older, the work from Facebook. It was called the Mystery Machine. And here they have the traces, right? Just like us and what I described. And now the way they are going to check if a trace is valid or not, it's using simply a state machine. But their paper is convincing. It was extremely simple. They claim that to have very good results. And I think it's also an approach to consider, maybe to use as a baseline. And then as you do more research, you can compare your results with Facebook. And that's all from my side.
Thank you, Professor. I think there are some questions popping up from the chat box. Could you please take a look at it? Thank you.
Let me see. Let me see if I can find. I'm trying now to find the chat box. I'm not sure if, let me see. Chat. So the first one, if you have any question, is there a comparison between decision trees and LSTM? No, we actually never. So the decision trees or the trees to model traces, this is usually the default. Actually, it's the default representation. If you use Zipkin, it will actually, you can easily generate a tree internally. We thought about it that you use prefix trees to do the detection, but at some point we wanted to explore more advanced technologies, so that's why we went for LSTMs. LSTMs have, nowadays we know that LSTMs have limitations. We've done more work on this. LSTM tend to be slow and they have some problems with memory, so actually we moved into other type of networks, and nowadays we went into attention networks. So we have actually another algorithms using other type of networks. And this is something also that we need to look into. How many models are considered typically in a trace? How many traces? Tricky to answer because it depends on, it's not, the number is not the most important. I would say that how many different traces we have is the important, because you can have 1 million traces, and if you know you only have five different combination of events or spans, then the number is not too relevant because the model will not learn more. I think we have tried at some point, we have like 10 million traces in a model. I think it was 10 million in some of the early experiments. How did you determine the output for training data? How did you determine the output for training data? I'm not sure if I understand the question. The next one, how can set the threshold for anomaly detection based on photometry? Yeah, so the threshold, this is the old problem of the threshold. I mean, how do we set it? It's a very good question. One of our experiments, we injected faults. So we inject fault into traces and to make them look abnormal. And then we verify empirically what will be the threshold. And then we have a possible threshold to use. Then, but this is not always sufficient, right? So, you know, it's 0.7 or it's 0.8, not clear. So what we have done was to develop a wrapper on top of the algorithm where we would be convinced that having one faulty trace does not indicate that you have a problem in your system. What are the odds of, you know, you have a large scale system and you have one faulty trace? Maybe it's a glitch. And at the end, maybe you don't even want to know about it. So we build a wrapper on it in one of the POCs where we would be interested on the rate. So not on the faulty traces, on the rate of the faulty traces. And the rate should be within, you know, 5%. And then what we actually analyze is a time series again. So we go back to time series and we analyze the rate of faulty traces. And if this rate increases, it means that we would have a problem. So meaning that we try to run away from the original problem of the threshold because we have difficulties to solve it. We say, well, let's build something on top, which will really be robust. And this seems to work quite well. We have different resources such as traces and logs. We have different resources such as traces and logs. Do we have models that combine multiple resources? So multimodality. If we have any, do you have any insight into the comparison of the methods that focus only on one resource and the methods that focus on multi-resources? The question is from Ekin. Interesting question. We did work with, again, TU Berlin. And I think that they're in the call, if I'm not mistaken. I think I saw Yasmin. Yeah, Yasmin is in the call. So we did the work with TU Berlin and they explored the combination two traces. So it was traces, metrics, and logs. We tried three. The results, when you analyze the three data types at the same time using networks, improves, but not too convincingly. So meaning that you should analyze the three without a doubt, it seems like it's better to analyze the three individually. So you will analyze traces and based on the result of traces, you may go to logs or metrics. We try to analyze actually the three in the same neural network. And here we didn't see really too much benefit. So there were some benefits, but I thought that the complexity to implement such an approach was too high based on the benefits. But again, this is called multi-modality analysis. I think we were the first ones to do it with TU Berlin. So I would tend to say that more research is needed. You know, other universities may be looking into the same problem and coming up with new ideas and new settings to explore. Any other question? So if there is no other question, thank you. Thank you for listening and for your interest. And if you have any further question, you can always drop me an email and I will be glad to discuss.